Okay, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Stephen Jones here with Venom Assembly, and here on center stage tonight. And we're going to take a talk to them. They got some stuff coming up. They got some new things, some old things, and we're going to dive right into it here. And guys, say they're my favorite bunch of guys. They really are. Very understanding. I got to tell you what, before we get deep into this, we can't get Marty mad because he's really got a dual identity. He does, doesn't he, guys? He doesn't he look like Sean Kennan
from Cobra Kai?
Yeah, Mr. Miyagi. Whoa. He was trying to do that crane thing out back, and the wind shifted. He fell over and it hit his head. And he hasn't been right since. So, anyway, guys, good evening. Welcome. Good to see you. Okay, and thanks for coming out tonight. And looking forward to having a little chit chat with you guys. A lot of things been going on with your band lately, and I was at practice a couple of weeks ago, and JT was kind of cutting loose up there. You guys, and then we got some new video, which I really like. Okay, we have to talk about how you got the video done, because you got some syncing in that. I just can't get done on my end. I'm not bad at doing my video, but at times I just can't get the syncing done right. Maybe you
try to sync the video up with the audio. It's not easy, but when you get it right, you know.
Yeah, it looks cool. I got close on one of them. They don't look like an old Japanese movie that's overdubbed in English.
like the old karate movies where the mouth doesn't match.
Yeah. Hello. So yeah, like that. So as a side note, I had recently acquired the old Ultraman series. I don't know if you ever saw that or not, but that has it in there. And I showed it to my one grandson. He says, "How come they're talking and the mouth is moving wrong?" Okay, you know. So anyway, so what have you guys been up to?
Practicing, writing. A little bit of recording. Yep. Writing new music. We got some new songs we're working on, Fractured. Got a new show coming out. We're going to be playing the Sherman Theater Showcase March 29th. So we're super excited with that. Here's some new music. We got a new song, Fractured. Some old classics. And we're going to be playing with two amazing bands, Intoxication. Huge shout out to Tony And the guys, they're just local legends, amazing for years around the area, opening for national acts. And Tony, got a chance to meet him, and, you know, just an amazing guy, amazing group. They're really helping us out. It's our, you know, first kind of show at the Sherman Theater, that area, and they're veterans. So we're super excited to have them. And then we have another band coming up from New York.
Yep, 25th Mission from Long Island. My buddy Mike Dial and Ed Breitkopf run that band over there. So they're a true power metal band, I would categorize them as. And they'll be coming down to open up this show for us at the Sherman.
Cool.
And all original music, and, you know, it's going to be an amazing night. Sherman Theater, huge shout out to them. They've been so great, very professional, the way they handle their tickets, their posters, communication. I can't say enough about the people there. So all original music, three amazing bands. We're really splitting the night. We're headlining, but, I mean, we're just honored to be playing with Intoxication and 25th Mission. So as far as we're concerned, we're just sharing the night with three amazing bands.
Wow. What's the capacity up there at the Sherman Theater?
I'm not sure. The showcase is 100, you know, right around there, but the larger, I'm not sure. I did get a chance to walk it today. They're making some changes and setting up for some different things. It's amazing what they can do with the space they have as well.
Yeah, no, when I say capacity, I mean, how many seats do they have up there? Do you know?
Depends. Sometimes they pull seats out. Like, I know they're getting ready for something else. So, but like fire code, I don't know. I'm sure, you know, they fit a few thousand people as big as it is.
Okay, I was curious because the Sherman Theater is very dominant in bringing in acts like yourself. And they just bowl it over as far as anything else is concerned. I mean, you know, in the area, we've got them. We got the State Theater down in Coopersburg. No, it's south of me here. Then you got the other State Theater that's over in Easton, which they're more of a center of the arts. And then we've got the Roxy sitting here. And all these old theaters are being converted and repurposed for stuff like what you're doing. And I think it's cool because it's neat to play in those theaters. It really is.
Yeah, it keeps original music out there, and, you know, they're bringing something in for the people, something to do. And, you know, yeah, it's pretty cool. We're excited to be there.
It's and it's a taste of the old, because they're old vaudeville theaters. And then, of course, you got the whole flair of the theater itself in the design. But at any rate, so you answered a question without me actually asking it, but when you said a flair for the old, you know, going back to some old stuff, John clarified it there. You don't play cover. Everything you do is original, right?
We play a cover here and there, but we're all original band. And, you know, JT's a new singer at the helm, writing new music. We got new stuff out there, and yeah, we pride ourselves on being an original hard rock band.
Well, before I go any further, let's take a moment here and just kind of go through and introduce the band and yourself, so people know who we're talking to.
Hey, I'm Ryan. I'm on drums.
Next. I guess that makes me next.
Yes.
On bass.
John on bass.
I'm singing, key vocalist, and Marty rocking the guitar.
Okay. I think an interesting point is that, I mean, knowing your band like I do, at some point, all of you were on drums at one point in time.
Almost. Well, I play the drums. I've, you know, done that, but not in this band. But, yeah, something like that.
At some point in time, you all started out on drums, and then you know, then you've graduated into your individual spots here, except Ryan. He's just, he refuses to accept other things. But, you know, there's a certain stubbornness there, but that's okay. That's good. At least you need someone to play the drums. Someone's got to do it, you know?
Someone has to stay on the drums after they start.
Yeah. It's, you know, so, but he does good. I'm really, honestly, Brian, I like your style. It's cool. So, you know, listening to, like what Johnny does with some of the licks, you know, on startup, he just sits there, starts playing with this stuff. And what you've described is, well, without me narrating it, how do you get started with the song? You know, you're sitting here, and what, does lightning strike you, and all of a sudden, the band, you know, how does it work?
I think it can start from any one of us. Inspiration is a fickle thing. I was watching a movie 2 days ago at work, and inspiration struck, so I started jotting down lyrics.
Oh, cool.
That might be our next one after this new one coming out, Fractured, which will be out. You know, we're still in the process of working on that, but Johnny's come up with, you know, awesome bass lines that have just progressed into full songs. Same with Marty. You know, I think even for that matter, drums can, you know, you find a really good groove and you just sit there in that pocket and it just builds. And, you know, any one of us can kind of do that. Yeah, I mean, it doesn't necessarily answer your question.
Well, I think it sparked somewhere, but we got a really good group here, I think, where we're writing something and you feed off of one person, you add an idea. You know, JT might hear a harmony, John hears a different bass part, a drum part, and I think the music's really taken to a path where, you know, the band sound, current band sound, it's very cohesive.
It is. You guys play off each other very well. I mean, Marty, I've followed you, and how long has it been now? A couple of years. I've seen a couple of different versions of Venom Assembly, and this version that you have in front of you now is probably the tightest version you have. And tight meaning that, you know, you guys respond to each other without knowing you're responding. You're just there, you know.
Yeah.
Ryan's playing the drums. He's doing this, and John's right behind him. And maybe John's not even thinking about it. He's just right there. He's right. And that's the mark of a very strong band. There's a gentleman who has since retired from playing. I can work like that with. I don't even have to watch him or really whatever. I just know where he's at. And you play, you get a great sound out of that, and you get good singing, and it just works, it gels. So, you're fortunate. It's hard to get something like that. You know, sometimes you get other bands, and it sounds like someone you're throwing a garbage can down a flight of steps with coming out.
Yeah, you gotta have chemistry.
And I'd say there's an energy that exists, and it's probably different for every band, but you can tell them. And I'll just say this, as much as I love the advances in technology today and appreciate, you know, all the streaming services that share our music and we're happy that it can be at someone's fingertips in the blink of an eye, you don't get the same experience that you do at a live show.
Right.
So I'll use that as a plug. You know, anyone who finds themselves available and, you know, within a reasonable drive to Sherman Theater on the 29th, exactly what you're talking about, Steve, you'll be able to witness it, because it's a feeling, it's an energy that exists, and it's hard to translate even through a video, you know, just popping some headphones on or earbuds or playing on your computer, or even through a, you know, kick-ass speaker system. That's great and all, but there is a live energy that exists.
Yes.
That I think people really need to start coming back to. It's, we're 4 years post COVID now. I might still be around, but it's not keeping us down. People got to back out to those venues and start looking at watching live music again.
My daughter went to see Trans-Siberian Orchestra, and
fantastic.
I missed the ticket. I couldn't get a ticket to go see it, so she decided to transmit it, you know, Facebook Live to me, and it was great. Okay. But nothing could compare to sitting in that auditorium and having that energy hitting you.
Oh, absolutely.
The lights. Yeah, I was there for that too.
So, yeah, that's, so you, you know, there's definitely, we got that. So, Marty.
Steve.
How?
So, help me, Spock. How long has Venom Assembly been around? Why can I not say that tonight? How long have you been around?
A couple of years. I mean, we started out with Frank and I. And shout out to Frank, my brother, you know, founding member. We started just jamming. He was a folk singer. And, you know, was rock music. I'm like, hey, you need to be singing some rock. So we did some stuff. And the band's progressed from more of like classic rock to a little heavier. To where, you know, I'm really happy with where it's going. It's a little bit of metal, it's a little bit of rock, it's a little hard rock, it's a little bit of, you know, everything, but it's really tight. It's harder music. But we've gone through a lot of progressions by probably about 6-7 years. But we really only started getting into like the live show piece of it until we got this group. We started a little bit. You know, shout out to Nick. We had some former members, Nick Awesome on guitar, Dave English vocals, amazing vocalist. But I think this is the group over the whole time that we got to the point where we're ready and have the ability and the want and the drive to do the live shows. So we've been a recording band for a lot, but this recording now with the live, it's just a whole new animal to be able to hear new music and then go see a band.
Yeah.
And then see them perform new songs and maybe a song that yet hasn't been released. Like that's magical stuff, at least for me as a music fan.
Oh yeah. Now, you and John are like the oldest members of the band, right?
Yeah, John's been in the band several years.
So how do you other two guys get involved with this thing? When it was like a car wreck you guys hit and say, hey, I got
Marty had an I had an ad on a Craigslist and I got a few phone calls, numerous, but Marty was the only one that I called back for whatever reason. And came down, met Marty and Johnny Bob one February in 2022. And here we are. I don't know how many chemtrails were out that day. But I Bob and Marty and that was it. They asked me right then and there to join and I said, sure, why not?
He was trying to sell a used mattress and I answered, I'm kidding. No, it's an amazing bass player and we just clicked right away and we're writing stuff and I'm really proud of the stuff we've written together as a band. So
my question is, how did you convince him to stay after he met Johnny Bob?
We'll save that for another show. But shout out to Johnny Bob. Played drums for us for a while, did some percussion, amazing guy.
He's a great guy. He's been over a couple of times. Just do a momentary, 15-second shout out. He's had a show with me for a while and broadcasting his own form of music. And he's cool. I haven't seen him for a while. I'm not sure what happened to him, but I was kind of surprised not to see him with you here. But he's a good guy. I have to try to find him and reach out to him again. But
we got JT on vocals, amazing. Ryan on drums. And I don't know if you have anything to add, but just awesome to have these guys playing and singing. Just amazing energy. I love listening to the vocals and hearing some of the new music. I get excited for the new music.
Yeah.
Yeah. Everything really does build off each other because, like you stated before, so Marty started out, recording the drums. When I had joined the band, I actually joined as the drummer, and Dave was our vocalist at the time. And I enjoy singing enough, and I was good enough, I'll say, to try and add some harmonies in there. And even just something, it doesn't have to be a lot. But it can just change the whole dynamic of a song. And we had that chemistry for a couple of the songs. And now me graduating to lead vocalist and adding Ryan, drumming might not seem as involved as something that actually carries a tune or melody or, involves notes. But I completely disagree to that mentality because your timing, what you hit when, and there's a whole feel to it. Mm-hmm. So, we all kind of have different ideas and everything we've done for a while now has just evolved.
Well, that's
and it really is exciting because you start with one idea and as you build to it, it turns into something nobody could have heard on their own.
Right.
And it requires all four of you to really make it sound the way it does translate to in practice. Yep. And then recording, and then what you can see and actually feel the energy live. So that's the coolest thing about music right now, especially with this group.
I find it amazing the sound you get. Two guitars and a drum. That's one of the things I find totally amazing. Sometimes I'll go out and I'll see a bass and a guitar and a drum, and you think, okay, they're playing bass, guitar, and drum, but it's the same sound. Just to say, playing, let's say, Mustang Sally and Some Kind of Wonderful, just to pick two songs, and they sound exactly the same. There's no change. Okay, and it's like, are you real? Okay, and you guys will change it up, and there's an entirely different sound between each song, and that's what's important. Because, for me, from the listener standpoint, I've got to hear that difference. I got to know that you're not playing Mustang Sally anymore and you're playing Some Kind of Wonderful, just to use titles. So, and then the bands that can't do that, You know, they're going to stay in a garage. And I've seen them, and then they end up in a garage. So, but you have that ability, and you've gotten some sounds, Marty, out of that guitar that really I would think come out of a synthesizer instead.
That's right.
Yeah, you get some awesome sounds out of that thing. So,
a lot of the 80s stuff, which I love. So, going back to influences.
And I watched Ryan when he was playing too. He's not, you're not an animal. Okay, like from the Muppets, you know, with the hair.
Close.
You know, you can sit there and he's thinking about it. But, in reality, you're very relaxed behind the guitar, drums. And they look really funny as a guitar. But anyway, but you're relaxed behind it. You know, you're doing your thing and you're, you know, and it's not, there's no stress. And John, he's in his own world during, and he comes up with a lick. And I said to him the one time when he was doing something, I said, that sounds pretty damn cool. He goes, okay, good. I mean, I might use that somewhere. And he's just, it's this whole creative energy that comes out. And again, I see a lot of the bands, we go out, girlfriend and I, we head out. And there are some bands that you see that energy in, and other bands, they just get up there in front and all they're doing is, you know, gin, 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 gin. It's like, okay, you know, I'll finish my rum and coke and I'm heading out somewhere else. And you guys attract attention and hold it. So, you know, the question I wanted to ask you, JT, you sing that, and I don't know what to call it. It's like this. Wah, rah, wah, wah. It sounds like you're doing a Godzilla on the microphone. I don't know what the hell to call it. But it's, you know, A, what's left of your voice after you do that damn thing? And B, how do you do it and keep your voice?
There are techniques, and I'm still working on them. I'm still pretty new to singing, so I don't want to blow my voice out. I want to be able to sustain these shows. We want to eventually build longer shows, you know, so to go out and do a 45 minute to an hour set is taxing enough. I want to be able to go out there and do a 2.5 hour set one day here, you know, in the nearer future. So a lot of practice, a lot of warm-ups, a lot of exercises I do. I do watch a lot of videos on those techniques for that vocal fry and the distortion and some of those sounds you're talking about where it just sounds like you're thrashing your vocal cords. But if you do it right, you can not only sustain it, but you're not doing damage in the process and you can continue to do it. And, you know, hopefully I can continue to do it better and better and better. you know,
is there a box like, I know Behringer had a box come out where you can make yourself sound like a robot and you can put all kinds of,
there's vocal pedals and stuff like that.
That's to like complement some of your techniques. I mean, we have some stuff like that, but it's not totally in place of it.
Okay, you're going to know that you're using a piece. I was in a band, we had a echo box. Okay, I'm probably the other stuff too. We had it, and the lead singer we had at the time needed it because she just didn't have the volume and range that we needed. And then when the echo box died, we packed up and went home. Yeah, so, but you know, I like to put a little bit of echo behind me because, again, I have an odd sounding voice when I'm not out there. I'm more of a country singer. I got that sound behind me like that. Hi, Tex. You know, and if I try to do rock or anything that's beyond mellow in the rock realm, I don't sound right doing it. So I throw some echo on it, I fake it, and I'm good. What you're doing, I tried that once, and I had a sore throat for an hour. So, you know, I think we should let John do it.
Oh, you're probably good.
Let JT do it.
Okay. Just trying to see what else we got going on here. We got most of your list done. Your inspiration, we talked about a little bit. Off time for fun. Are you guys like the Monkees? You push like a bed down the street and you're going, hey, we're the Monkees. You know,
we love the Monkees.
You guys.
How about influences real quick? Because we touched on it, but I think we talked about that one time before, and it was really cool to kind of hear.
All right, let's talk about the influences. We'll do that, and we'll talk about fun, too. So, yeah. Your influences, we'll start with Ryan. Ryan, who's your influence? And please don't give me a guitar player.
My range of influences, a lot of classic rock. I do like Dave Matthews Band, Tool, Living Color.
Ooh,
you know, just a real wide range.
Okay, Johnny, yep. Who's your guy? I know who you like. Okay. This guy who plays bagpipes.
Kenny Lee, Steve Harris, Billy Sheehan, old school disco, Rick James.
Oh yeah.
James Jameson from back in the day, Carole Kaye writing all those hits and whatnot. So you know that's all the basic building blocks and what's his name? Chris Squire from Yes. Of course, Geddy Lee. Of course, Led Zeppelin and stuff like that. You know, it's so much. It just all comes out. You know.
Okay. Yeah. So, JT, who's your influence? I know who your influence is for singing. I know it. I know it. Don't even say it. I know who your influence is. The Osmonds. The Osmonds, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, Danny Marie. Yeah. I forget the rest, but yeah, all of them. Yeah.
You never heard that scream?
The Osmonds! Backwards.
Yeah. Just like Chicago.
Yeah, when you play the Osmonds backwards, it's mental health and you know that. Never mind. Go ahead. Who's your influence?
Oh, I have so many, and it depends on the genre because I appreciate all genres too. I think right now and for a long time, Corey Taylor is someone that I do try and emulate. I'm not there yet, but he's one of the biggest vocal influences. And one of my earliest influences, I was very into nu metal when I was a teenager. So Sonny from POD, I think he's awesome. And, but really it comes down to kind of the collaboration of all these different, just like, the four of us are needed to make some of the sounds you hear. Mm-hmm. My inspiration came from a whole lot of different places, different genres. And that was dependent on the times of my life too. So that'd be an extremely long list, but I'd say right now, vocally, Corey Taylor is my main influence right now.
Okay, and now we come to Marty, Eddie Van Halen.
So I would say I love 80s music, guitar playing. 70s, I'm a drum guy, but I like a lot of the B-side stuff, like Autograph and. Steve Lynch from Autograph, his techniques, some stuff that George Lynch was doing, Yngwie, Steve Vai. So I try to take some of that, make it my own, come up with different ideas and techniques and stay current for what some people are doing nowadays and homogenize it. But, you just can't beat the technique and some of that over the years. But like I said, I try to get off the beaten path and some stuff that maybe you don't always hear. That's pretty much influence, but similar to Johnny. I grew up on Led Zeppelin, Cream. Not a huge Hendrix fan, but got to appreciate the guys from the 70s, some old 50s guitar players. Elvis had some really cool guitar players doing some cool, picking techniques and that. So chicken picking. Big Joe Satriani fan. So that's my influences on the guitar.
Okay. And just to keep the field level, my influences on the piano, Jerry Lee Lewis. Yeah.
I can hear that.
Yep. Jerry Lee, I like watching...
Liberace?
Yeah, Liberace. Yeah. No, seriously. You ever saw that man play?
No, that's his fashion influence. I wish my brother George were here.
But, yeah, Liberace, he's like this, but the man can play a piano... Unbelievable. Okay. He's also kind of weird, but that's okay. But the first influence is Chico Marx. Okay. I don't know if you're familiar with who
Chico. The Marx Brothers?
The Marx Brothers.
Oh, playing the piano. Yes, yes. My dad used to watch it. He played and he'd do this and like little yeah. gun shooting at the piano. Yep. Yeah.
His finger, he dances on the piano.
I mean, he's actually really good.
He's wild. I saw a clip of his playing a high back piano, and he played the Three Stooges theme with an orange rolling up and down. So
the orange play.
Yeah, and I said, aren't you glad you did that? So, I'm really sorry about that. Anyway, but I'm pumped, yeah. It's an interesting, just where you grab your influences from. You know, you see all these different people, the wide variety of influences you guys have. And, you know, how you can bring all that talent that you watched and grew up on, and you bring it all together, and it comes in a whole, totally different sound. And that's what's cool.
I think it's neat too where you get it from. Like, I still remember watching. Remember, you ever seen the movie Crossroads, the old guitar movie?
Hell yeah.
I think so. That was a while ago for me, but yeah.
I got here. Jack Butler. That's Steve Vai. Okay. Steve Vai, Jack Butler. So if you didn't know who Steve Vai was in the music, but did you watch that? How cool it is, you know, he was. Like, it was real. I still remember watching it. I'm like, man, I want to be like that guy.
You're talking about music and movies, I loved the Blues Brothers.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You know, I'm a blues guy, so you know, I loved it. So, and more music you get into it, the better. I'm if you don't do the right music for the movie, I won't even watch it. When Sean Connery did that one James Bond one that wasn't attached to the main string, was it Never Say Never or something like that? And they couldn't use the James Bond music. I didn't bother. I didn't want to see it. I want the James Bond music. Okay. And, you know, there's certain, I just want to see it. That's it. I need to have the music with it. But anyway, so do you guys play together? You rock together? Do you have fun together? Or do you go your separate ways after the gig and after practice?
We try. You know, Marty's always saying, hey, let's shoot pool, let's throw darts. I mean, we try. We certainly do. We all have kids. Marty and I have young ones. Ryan and Johnny got some older kids. We all have full-time jobs. And, you know, we're close enough. Obviously, practice isn't too much of a hassle to be able to get together. We get together, you know, at least once a week, sometimes a couple times a week. So we're close enough. But it's not like we're next-door neighbors. You know, I was in those bands when I was in my teens. And, you know, you could live for just hanging out and skateboarding and biking and going in and band practice and eating some bagel bites or a hot pocket and throwing on a movie. I mean, those were the days, don't get me wrong. I'd love to do it with these guys, but you know, we're adults and life and responsibility takes priority. So
we still get together here and there, like, you know, fun stuff, but it's funny. And I get to think about it. I'm like, hey, okay, let's work on a song. We're going to record. Okay. Get your calendar out. Yeah. We have an hour here in the day, but we make it work. That's what I'm super happy. Like, well, that's one thing is we haven't let anything slow the band down.
Well, coordinating four schedules is tough. I mean, yeah. Just right from the top there, it's, you know, just getting your four schedules together just for practice alone, you know, and of course then for the gigs, you know, that's a lot to do, you know, and like you say, you got little ones and been there, done that, bought the t-shirt. So it's tough. So anything else you guys want to cover before we wrap here?
No, I don't think so. A huge thank you to you, Steve. I know we tried this a couple times to no avail, but third time's the charm. And you know what? It worked out.
Yeah.
I just want to mention again, March 29th, it's Good Friday. It's a good night to go out. It's a Friday night before Easter. Go out, have fun, enjoy good people, you know, good bands, live music scene, and we'll see you hopefully at the Sherman Theater.
So,
look for our newest song, Fractured. That'll be coming out soon. We'll probably have a teaser coming out sooner, but
send me a link to that. Okay,
yeah,
send some links, and then I'll put them at the end of the in the end credits on this.
Yeah, Amazon, Spotify, YouTube, check us out. If you like our stuff, there's more to come.
Okay, we'll keep this thing going. Just to put it up there, I'm working on a new website. It's going to talk about bands that we promote, and you guys are going to be in that. Okay,
cool.
Got Bands at Noon. I want to bring you guys back in on that. That's also going to be part of the new website. We got a whole bunch of things that I've been working on, changing things up, because it's been the same old for a while, and I think it's time I kind of scrub things down a little bit. Okay, one of the times.
We certainly look forward to that, Steve. We love working with you. We appreciate your time and
thank you.
And your content. I think you do a lot for the Valley, and may I speak for all of us when I say thank you.
I appreciate that. I really do. So I try, and it's fun. You know, I will say, to capitalize on that and to kind of bring us to a full circle, music heals. It does. You know, whether you're doing rock, you're doing easy listening, even if you're doing funk and hip hop, if you're enjoying it, music will heal. And that's what it did for me. And I loved it. I've been playing for 50 years. And maybe not perfectly. Pardon me? Yeah, I mean, I think the last 25 is going to hurt.
What they say.
So, on that note, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for tuning in here tonight with Steve Jones on Rock in the Valley Center Stage. We got Venom Assembly here. And as I said, this is the third time for us. We had some glitches. Okay, I never have bloopers, do I? No. But we had them here, but we're going to get this one out. And make sure you catch me at the Sherman Theater on March 29th, you said, right?
Yep. Yes, sir.
And we'll be posting the links at the end of the show here so you can see how to get to it. Thank you very much for tuning in. Have yourselves a great night and an awesome tomorrow.
Woo! Yeah. See you.